Now I'd like to introduce Dr. Tracy Nichols, who will provide a little more information about himself. Dr. Nichols?
Yes, I am Dr. Tracy Nichols, and I'm located here in Douglasville, Georgia. My wife and I have a business that we operate, and we do counseling. Also, we do spiritual counseling as well for those who may be going through the substance abuse usage. We work strongly with the drug court as well as surveillance officers and as a support system for Douglas County Courts, a Douglas County Drug Court program. We've been with them for 5 years now. We have a mentoring program that we have as well. So we mentor not just teenagers from 12 to 17, but also adults who may be going through this type of usage, substance abuse. So I'm here today to be able to present the spirituality piece, substance use and recovery, all combining together. And I'm hoping that we all get something out of it today. And I'm excited to be able to share with you what I have come up with to be able to deliver to you. All right, here are the objectives today that we want to review. First of all, learn the benefits of spirituality in recovery. And learning the benefits of recovery in spiritual, learning the benefits of spirituality in recovery. In other words, you will be able, once you walk away from this particular webinar, you will learn what the benefits are of spirituality as it relates to recovery. Because I think that sometimes people really feel that they can do it on their own. And what I have found, even as a pastor of 21 years, what I have found is that there's so many benefits from your spirituality as it relates to your recovery. Because I think that when people isolate themselves and feel as though that they can do it on their own, what tends to happen is when you isolate yourself, you start feeling like you don't need anybody. You don't need any help. But when it comes down to you connecting your higher power within yourself, and you connect yourself with others, other spiritual beings as well, then your recovery will sometimes be such an easy thing for you because, see, you're not on the journey by yourself. And I think that once we find out the benefits of spirituality and recovery, then we can be able to offer it more to those that we deal with on a regular basis because, you know, I know that we all deal with other people, family members as well, that we're saying, okay, I'm praying for you, but what are you actually praying? And how do you get them to see the spiritual side versus the religious side? So that would be the first objective. The second objective would be learn how to implement spirituality through recovery. So it's not about a what, but also a how. So in other words, how do we implement spirituality through recovery is what we're going to be discussing as well. Because I think that a lot of people, they'll say that it's okay for them to be in a church, but not understanding is not about the building, but understanding the connection, the spiritual connection that you have with your higher being, with your higher power. Because when you tap into yourself and you understand that spirituality is taking things to the next level. So understanding and learning how to implement spirituality through recovery would be number two of the objectives. Number three, learn different ways of embracing spirituality. And see, this is very important. And the reason that it is important and vital to the success of those who are in substance abuse recovery is when you understand that there's more than one way to tap into your spirituality, there's more than one way for you to be able to connect to your higher power, because now you don't have any limitations on that. So we're going to learn the different ways of embracing spirituality. And point number four, learn how to connect to your higher power within you. So I think what I want to share with you on this is I don't want you to get the religious mindset mixed up with the spirituality. Spirituality is a growth. And sometimes I think that we use religion as an escape goat sometimes when people do that. Oh, I'm saved. I'm in church. I'm always saved. But it's not about that. But when you begin to learn how to connect to your higher power within you, there are sometimes you won't be able to face the pastor at church or the motherboard or whomever. There are certain times that you're not going to be able to reach the church members, period. But once you understand what spirituality is, and once you connect to your higher power within you, that's when the growth actually develops. Not just you sitting in church. And I'm not knocking you going to church. I'm not saying that. But what I am saying is tapping into your higher power within you. All right, now, the greatest revolution of our generation is the discovery that human beings, by changing the inner attitudes of their minds, can change the outer aspects of their lives. And this was quoted by William James. And you know, that was very powerful. When I looked at that, I said, I gotta share this one here because the greatest revolution of our generation is the discovery that human beings, by changing the inner attitudes of their minds, can change the outer aspect of their lives. Because everything starts with a thought. We know that everything starts with a thought. Then you feel it in your heart. And after you feel it in your heart, then you activate it through your action, MHA. Mind, heart, and action. And I think that once we understand the inner person on who we really are and who God designed us to be, then we can understand what spirituality is, and we can understand that we must evolve. We must continue to evolve in spirituality, because you can't do it by yourself. You can't do it alone. You cannot do it by yourself. A lot of people think that they can, but they can't, because spirituality is a part of you, regardless of how you worship God, regardless of the way you communicate with God. As long as you have a higher power that you can go to that is higher than yourself, then you're going to be just fine in that aspect. Wait a minute, I think I did that twice. Now we're going to talk about what is spirituality. What is spirituality? First of all, spirituality is the experience and integration of meaning and purpose in life through connectedness with self, others, art, music, literature, nature, or of a higher, I mean, or a power greater than oneself. Now, what I just said earlier, as it relates to having the higher power, spirituality, when you experience what your purpose is, when you experience connecting to others in life, when you experience and understand that you are one with God. There's no separate entity. You are one with God. And regardless, I think that sometimes church people, let me just say this. Sometimes I think that church people push people out the door because they don't look the way they look, they don't act the way that they act, and they don't go by the rules that the church body has come up with. But when you're looking at spirituality and you're understanding that you are aware of who you are and whose you are, when you are connected like that, regardless of what you're going through, regardless of what you may be facing, the spiritual part of you gives you your identity. Religion doesn't give you your identity, but the spirituality gives you your identity and also gives you your purpose in life. Spirituality is very key. It is very important that we tap into our spirituality. It is very critical that we utilize our spirituality on a daily basis, not just when things happen to us, but on a daily basis. Because in recovery, what I have seen and witnessed, a lot of people began to tap into their spiritual being. They began to tap into the higher power because they now realize they can't do it on their own. They tried it, but they can't do it on their own. And at that particular point is when the light bulb popped in some of their heads. And they told me, they was like, Dr. Nichols, you know what? I really don't believe in going to the church all the time because they always condemn me. But when I read the Bible for myself, when I began to understand the spiritual side of who God really was, then I began to want to change. I began to want to grow. I began also to do things intentionally to make sure that I didn't relapse. But it's because I found my voice. I found my purpose. So spirituality is so important. And so there you have it, what spirituality really is. It's three-dimensional cognitive behavior, process, relationship with self, others, and a higher power. Those are the three dimensions there that you're going to always have in your life, dealing with yourself, dealing with others, and dealing with your higher power. You're going to always have those three because in this world, you cannot make it without those three, without knowing who you are, without linking up with other people to assist you to make sure that you go to the next level as it relates to your greater calling, and that is with your higher power. Because, see, I don't know if you guys have experienced this before, but I think that sometimes we tend to try to push religion versus spirituality. And there's a difference, there's a difference. And so when you're looking at the spiritual component of a person, when you're looking at the self, you're looking at how others are connected to you, you're looking at how you and others are connected to a higher power. And those are the people and those are the things that you want to be able to allow to happen in your life, those things. You want to be able to be aware of yourself, know who you are, and know whose you are, and then also know who to be connected to and who not to be connected to. Because I think that sometimes we connect ourselves with people who probably is going through the same thing. And sometimes you have to pull yourself away from those people and connect yourself with people who has gone through what you are trying to go through so that you would be able to understand that you're not alone, you're not by yourself. Now, what is substance use, you may ask? What is substance use? Addiction is characterized by inability to consistently abstain, impairment in behavioral control, craving, dimension, recognition of significant problems with one's behavior and interpersonal relationships, and a dysfunctional emotional response. So when you look at substance use, you find so many people go into substance use based upon certain events around that. And I think that certain events causes people to trigger in utilizing drugs. And what I mean by causes a trigger, in other words, if you know that your entire family normally drinks, smoke, and all of those things and use drugs, you're more prone to it than what you think. However, doesn't necessarily mean that you have to go the same route. When you understand your triggers and you understand how to utilize problem-solving techniques, you more likely won't turn to drugs for the answer. A lot of people utilize drug for a temporary fix, and a lot of clients that I serve have said those things to me. They were like, "Dr. Nichols, part of my problem is, my childhood wasn't this, and my mom did this, my dad did these things, and it caused me to not feel loved. So therefore, it was a void that I was trying to fill." And a lot of people, even today, are trying to fill a void by utilizing drugs and alcohol. However, those voids would never be filled. Those are only temporary fixes. And with those temporary fixes, those temporary fixes could come into a substance abuse usage where it is to a point where you lose your family, you lose yourself, you lose everything around you, houses, cars, jobs, everything. You lose all of those things because you don't know how to deal with your issues. And a lot of time, it only takes you to tap into the spiritual side of yourself, as well as also reaching out for therapy, reaching out for counseling. And I know a lot of people think, "Oh, well, counseling is for weak people and this and that." I don't think that's the case. I think that counseling could be effective to anybody who really wants to help and anybody who really chooses to actually seek out the help that they need in order for them to be able to conquer the substance abuse issues that they have. But you can't conquer something where you're not willing to recognize. And that's part of the problem. And that's where we go wrong with misleading people to just tell them, oh, just pray about it. God got you. That's not true. God has us, yes, but that's not true. Just pray about it. Faith without works is dead. You also have to teach people how to put in the work and also connect people to the right people in order to get the right outcome that that person needs. Because they're already trying to abstain from using drugs. They're already having these out of control behaviors. They're having the cravings. They're having all of these things, and they're having behavior issues, getting into physical altercation with people, not just verbally, but also physical altercation. So we have to do a better job at teaching people who are on drugs about the spirituality and the importance of utilizing spirituality through them trying to maintain sobriety or trying to get to their sober mind. Now, what is recovery? Let's look at recovery. Recovery is a process of change through which individuals improve their health and wellness, live a self-directed life, and strive to reach their full potential. Now, when you have people in recovery, here's the key element and the key component. When you have people in recovery, that is a very sensitive time for them because it could be the smallest thing that happened to them that caused them to shift and go back to using drugs, and now twice as hard than the first time because now that's called a relapse. So now they have went back into that mindset of nobody cares because they've allowed a trigger. They've allowed a trigger to happen in their lives to cause them to go back. Instead of them looking for the resolution to that trigger, it's easy to go back to something that you are so familiar with than you to stand and say, I'm not going back. I need assistance. I need help. A lot of people, when they really, really want to change, when they're having problems, they're going to call their therapist. That's why it is important that everyone who's in recovery needs to have a therapist. Everybody, because you need to have someone to talk to when you are having those cravings and those triggers happen. You need to have someone to talk to. You need to be talking to someone. You need to actually have a not a support person. You need to have a sponsor. Someone who's gone through what you're going through so that they can walk you through the courses of recovery. And now we're going to look at the features of spirituality. Now, a lot of people may not know what the features of spirituality really is, but I just wanted to throw a few of them out to you. The features of spirituality, hope. Let's look at hope for a second. When you look at spirituality, all a person needs is just a hope, just a small amount of hope, and trying to say, I know if I could just get in tune with my spiritual side, if I know that I can just, that hope that I do have is going to increase, is going to elevate me, but I just need just a small amount of hope. This is spirituality. This is not religion. That's one of the features of spirituality. Then meaningful connections. When you are spiritual, you want to connect with those who are spiritual minded, not religious rules, meaningful connections. Those who are going to challenge you, because there'll be times that you don't want people to challenge you, but if you're connected to meaningful connections and you're connected to people who really mean you some good, guess what takes place? That hope increases. It increases again because why? You have meaningful connection. Now, meaning and purpose. Now, you got hope, you got meaningful connection. Now, we're looking at the meaning and purpose. Now, when you look at your meaning in life, what does your life mean? What is your purpose? All of that is spirituality because it digs deep within us. It digs deep within us. But a lot of people don't have hope. A lot of people don't have meaningful connection. A lot of people don't have their own, they don't know the meaning and purpose of their own life. But the spirituality piece connects one to hope, meaningful connection, and meaning and purpose. That's another feature, again, of spirituality is meaning and purpose. Then we have the fourth one, forgiveness and acceptance. Forgiveness is key in recovery because a lot of people are shameful of the things that they've done. Oh, I just feel bad because I let my family down and all of my family are in church, and here I am out here doing this. Forgiveness is key. Because see, if you don't forgive yourself, it's really not going to be a beneficial thing. Let me tell you why. When you forgive yourself and you tap into the spiritual side of yourself, and then you understand that when you forgive yourself and you ask God, the higher power, to forgive you, you'll be at peace. You won't be wrestling all over the place, and you won't want to go over here and say, oh, I'm going to use because nobody wants me. I don't nobody want to accept me. But when you start forgiving yourself and accepting yourself, then others will forgive you and accept you also. And even if those who are around you don't want to forgive you, it's okay. Sometimes you can't connect yourself with everybody because everybody aren't meant to connect to you, and you're not meant to connect with everybody. Know your connections. Because see, sometimes your connections can be good, sometimes they can be bad. So when you have forgiveness and acceptance, that goes back to hope. It gives you hope. It increases even larger, meaningful. Connections there, meaningful meaning and purpose. Because why? You've forgiven yourself. You've accepted yourself. You've accepted the fact that, hey, I need a spiritual, I need a higher power. I need spirituality in my life. Because once I forgive myself, once God has forgiven me, I've accepted myself. God has accepted me. God knows that we all got issues. Just your issues may be different from the next person, but guess what? We all have issues. And then the sense of belonging. Spirituality teaches us about the sense of belonging. So when we have that sense of belonging, that means that we have purpose. That means we have meaning. That means we have hope. That means we have meaningful connection. That means that we are forgiven. We forgive others. That means that we accept ourselves. We accept others because why? We now feel like we are a part of something. And that is so crucial, and that is so important. Relationships and community—that is a pivotal point for everybody in everybody's life. Relationships and community, meaning that there be certain things in your community that, in relationships in your community that you can link up with. You may have a group over here that says, you know, this church talks about the recovery piece. This church over here talks about the 12-step program, which also involves about the spirituality, because 12-step program focuses on a higher power. So when you have those relationships in the community, you have others that will also keep you in check as well. The features of substance use, fear. Substance use gives you fear, secrets and hiding. Self-ridicule, shame, actions against your morals, barriers to intimacy, self, others, and spirit, disconnection, isolation. Those are the signs right there when a person is using and don't want to tell you about that. So those are the features to that one right there. All right. And why spirituality is important in drug substance recovery. Addiction takes away our ability to be spiritual. It disconnects us spiritually, basically. So when we connect ourselves spiritually, then it also helps us physically, mentally, and emotionally. It helps us. But those features of substance use will only be will only alleviate themselves once you understand your spirituality with your higher power. Let's look at the facts about substance use. This here is a nationwide. These are nationwide numbers here. 20 million Americans over the age of 12 have an addiction, have an addiction. And that is true because I deal with kids from 12 to 17 in my mentoring program. So yes, that is very accurate. 2.6 million people with addiction have a dependence on both alcohol and illicit drugs. That would be very accurate as well. 6.8 million people with an addiction have a mental illness. That's true. When you have the co-occurrence happening, you have to treat both. You can't treat just one. You have to treat the substance abuse as well as the mental disorder. And over 90% of those with an addiction began drinking, smoking, or using illicit drugs before the age of 18. Those are all facts. Benefits of spirituality and recovery. Researchers have well established that spirituality and religious involvement play a role in reducing substance use. These are the things that it can give more optimistic, hopeful outlook on life, an increased sense of social support, less anxiety, greater resilience to stress, helps the participants gain better coping skills, which in turn helps them to remain sober. So when you're looking at all of these benefits of spirituality, who wouldn't want to tap into the higher power? Because those are the things, these are the benefits of spirituality in recovery. These are the benefits that I've just spoken to you. It provides them with strength to remain abstinent because now you have accountability partners around you. And guess what? They're going to give you the strength that you need to remain sober. And it helps protect program participants from feeling a panic that may accompany sobriety as well. The benefits of spirituality and recovery. Here, I just want to go through this right here. When you see the green, that's the lower numbers. And where you see the, I guess, lavender color, that's where you see the higher numbers. Where it's very important is right here, these colors here. These are very important. I can't hardly see that one. The belief strengths right here. I can't see that one. Religious one. I need better glasses, you guys. I'm sorry. I hope you all can see that. So these are remission rates associated with five different measures of spirituality here. So those are the benefits of spirituality and recovery right here. So as you can see, all of the graphs here, the higher ones, you can see here that spirituality is actually beneficial in recovery. It is actually beneficial in recovery. Okay, implementing spirituality through recovery, supporting community. Again, we got to go back to that. Supporting community, spend more time with loving and encouraging family and friends, reduce distractions. Sometimes we have so many distractions, not just phone, TV, internet, and news. Sometimes you're distracted by other people who want you to continue to live in that lifestyle. Participate in recovery, community play. In other words, you want to be able to get with groups that's going to help you, that's going to help you do those particular, that's going to help you grow within yourself, and also that's going to also challenge you not to use. You have the drug addiction education and counseling. You need those type of things. So those implementing spirituality through recovery, those are some of the things that you really, really want to keep in mind. Now, implementing spirituality through recovery, helping others overcome addiction. Again, when you have someone there to assist you, that is a way for you to not relapse. That's relapse prevention right there when you have someone there. And it will also assist you with how to live your purpose, live your life. Those are the things there that you definitely want with relationships that you're connecting to. You always want to connect yourself with those who believe in you and who's going to support you and who's going to push you to the next level. Do not get with someone who's still using just because you're saying, well, I feel bad for him, so I want to bring them on. Be careful of that because, see, you're still fragile yourself. So you don't want to relapse into back into the same mindset, back into the same addiction. You don't. You want to be with someone who's going to hold you accountable. You need accountability partners. You need people to really hold you accountable for the things that you say that you want to do. You want to not relapse, then you need people around you that's going to help you have the relapse prevention training and techniques that you desperately need. The 12-step approach, self-service, develop compassion, admission of powerlessness is the first step of liberation, in other words, of freedom. You have to admit, if you don't admit that you have a problem, then you're not going to have solutions to that problem. That's the first thing. But you know, we admitted we were powerless over alcohol, that our lives have become unmanageable. So therefore, again, when you admit, hey, I got a problem, I have an addiction, I need help, and you have to mean what you say and say what you mean. What can we believe in? Importance of an open mind, turning our will over to a higher power. Come to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. How shall we let God into our lives? Willingness is the key. God is not going to force himself into your life. You have to accept him into your life. You got to make decisions. You have to make decisions that is going to be conducive to you at the point that you are at that moment. You have to make those decisions. No one can force you to accept God. No one can force you to do absolutely anything. Everything you go through in life is a choice, not a force. Remember that. It's a choice, not a force. But if you understand tapping into your spirituality, God will be right there every step of the way, and he'll connect you to the right people and disconnect you also from those that you shouldn't be connected to. Number four, how instincts can exceed their proper functions. Step four is an effort to discover our inabilities, our liabilities. You have to know what you believe in. You have to have some morals. You also have to understand, too, that when you discover different liabilities in your life, you need someone to hold you accountable. You need someone to hold you accountable. Admitting to God, to ourselves, and to another human being the exact nature of our wrongs. Confession. Confession. Confession is good for your soul. Confession is good for the soul. When you admit that you have a problem and you admit what that problem is, now you get a chance to work with someone who's going to assist you in that area. Step six is necessary to spiritual growth. Recognition of difference between striving for objective and perfection. We're entirely ready to have God remove all things, defects of character. Now, you got to put in some work also. God is not going to do it for you. You have to put in the work. Faith without works is dead. You can have hope, but hope without works is dead also. You have to use the totality of everything, mind, body, soul, and spirit. All of those things you have to do. And you have to also, again, you got to admit to yourself, I'm not perfect. I may fail somewhere, but I'm not going to stay down. I'm gonna fall for a moment, but I'm gonna get back up because I have people around me who's encouraging me. Step seven is change in attitude, which permits us to move out of ourselves towards God. Humbly ask him to remove our shortcomings. So, in other words, when we are accepting, and hear me clearly, when we are accepting to the things of God and allowing him to remove things out of our lives, we got to open our hearts and minds to receive those things. We can't just push them away and say, oh, that's not God. Sometimes God comes in different ways and different forms. It's not one way. It's not like Burger King having it your way, but it is definitely God coming in different ways to show you that he's still there and he's not going anywhere. Step eight is the beginning of the end of isolation. Made a list of all persons we had harmed and became willing to make amends. So, in other words, if you know that you've wronged someone, go back. Don't isolate yourself. Go back, apologize, ask for forgiveness, move on. That's what you have to do. Readiness to take consequences of our past and take responsibility for well-being of others is the spirit of step nine. Direct amends to such people wherever possible, except when to do so would injure them or others. So, in other words, there are consequences behind your actions. For every action, there is a reaction. Some people lose their families behind all of this. Number 10 is self-searching becomes a regular habit. Self-restraint, first objective. Continue to take personal inventory, and when we were wrong, promptly admit it. I mean, take accountability. Take accountability. If you've wronged someone, admit it and be done. Meditation has no boundaries. Meditation and prayer to the main channels of higher power. There's no limitation to meditation. Some people get up and they close their eyes, they meditate, they breathe, breathe in and out, and they just become one with the universe. And what is spiritual awakening? A new state of consciousness, and being is received as a gift, a free gift. Being awake spiritually, that's important. That is very important. Different ways of embracing spirituality. Also, recognize your creator. Be humble. Recognize who he is in your life. He's not everything in everybody else's life the way that you see, the way that they see it, but recognize your creator yourself. Seek opportunities to put more love into the world. Love and be lovable as well, loving and lovable. Recognize your own mistakes. Take responsibility. Set aside time each day to spend in spiritual reflection and contemplation, because that's important. That gives you your strength. Forgive anyone you have not forgiven. Be kind. Forgive people. Move forward. You can't keep holding on to something that you're trying to let go of. If you're trying to let go of the past, forgive people. Move forward. Forgiveness is for you, not for them. Remember that. Try to see the good in others. Be positive. Be positive. Become more accepting, gracious to people as well. So, and when you try to see the good in others, others will see the good in you as well. Remember, whatever you reap, whatever you sow, you're reaping. So, sow good seeds on good measures, good ground, and receive good responses back. Take stock of your thoughts and behavior. In other words, it's time to grow. It's time to grow. It's time to go out of one position into the next. You can't grow standing in the same mindset. Use each interaction to be the best, most powerful version of yourself, a conduit of God's love. That's exactly what it is. That's exactly what it is. Humility, recognition to see ourselves as we are, visitors in this life, as guests to recognize the opportunities and gifts that surrounds us. Be humble. Be humble. Don't be cocky. You can be confident and not be cocky. Don't get it twisted. You can be humble and you can be confident, but yet not cocky. Some people may look at you like you're being cocky because you finally tap into your spiritual side and you're okay with that. You're okay with that. So humility is important. Prophetic courage is our affirmations to declare what's right. It is the strength, the confidence to perceive granted to us by our beliefs. Prophetic courage. Knowing who you are, knowing whose you are, and knowing your purpose, the prophetic courage. It's okay to be courageous. Do not be afraid to step out of your comfort zone. Do not be afraid to step into the things that God has for you. That's different ways of embracing your spirituality. Holiness, spirituality transforms us by allowing us to participate in that which is holy. In other words, those things that are acceptable to God, those things that are pure to God. We know that drugs are not pure. We already know that. So if we're trying to get off of drugs, we're not going to continue to do those things. We're going to try to keep a holy mindset. And holy does not mean that you're perfect. Holy just means that you're trying to get into a position where God wants you to be. That's what holiness really, really represents. And it's just teaching us that we should abstain from those things that are not pleasing to God. That's what holiness is in a nutshell. Action. Spirituality is not spiritualism, a system of beliefs that diminishes the significance of our responsibility to make a difference. Rather, it is a behavior promoting to power the spirit. Spirituality and religion are two totally different things. I think a lot of people get that mixed up. I'm going to break it down to you real quickly before my time is up. Your action speaks so loud, a person can hear words you say. So you can quote all the scriptures, that doesn't mean anything. But when your action lines up with the spiritual things of God, then people will begin to read you and not reading the scriptures that you're reading and trying to quote to them and trying to make them feel bad about themselves. People need to see that where you're coming from is a loving way. People need to see and understand that you are genuine where you're coming from, that you're authentic and you're not synthetic. People want to see your actions, not just your words. How to connect to your higher power within. The following three concepts will help you. Okay, here we go. Acceptance, surrender, active involvement. Acceptance, realizing that substance use is a chronic disease. You got to accept that. You got to own that. You got to accept it. You got to own it. Surrender, giving up that control, giving up that power. Say, you know what, God, I surrender my all to you. I can't do this by myself. And actively involvement. Here's the thing. Get involved into programs, get into things that are going to help develop you to the person that you're supposed to be. Those are the type of things that you need in your life. Acceptance, surrender, and active involvement. Religion versus spirituality, a set of beliefs, rituals, and practice regarding belief in God or gods to be worshiped. Spirituality, a personal search for meaning in life, for connection with all things, and for the experience of a power beyond yourself. That's why I said earlier, it's not about the set of rules. It is about you understanding your meaning in life and also connecting with God. Spirituality does not mean to follow religion only, but can also be experienced through other ways. You have the ability to choose your higher power also. Nobody can tell you to just do it this way. You have a bill. No one else can do it for you. That is something that you must do yourself. Love, music, nature, those are the things as well. But the realities of these things, you know, when you're looking at the love, the music, nature, there are different ways that you can connect with God. Some people connect through music. Some people go out in nature. They connect that way as well. So there's more than one way to do it. So these are the things here, what I just said earlier. And so we'll move on to that. And those are my references there. And I am ready for questions. I hope I didn't go too fast, but I wanted to make sure that I was obedient to the time given to me. And I do want to answer, you know, some of your questions. This is my contact information if you would like to get in contact with me. And I am available through all the information that you see up there. And that is it for me. I'm waiting on your questions. And thank you all so much for having me. Thank you so much for having me. I hope that something was said here to enlighten you, to be able to understand spirituality, substance use, and recovery. I'm hoping that you can take something from the webinar and be able to utilize it for people that you're working with, because a lot of us work with people in the field. So I'm hoping that something that I said today enlightened you so that you can enlighten others. Iron sharpens iron. Questions?
Thank you, Pastor. I have a few questions that were asked as some of our participants registered. One of the questions,
okay,
is, can you obtain recovery without spirituality?
My answer would be no. Let me tell you why. Because it's four levels. It's four levels. You got physical, which is what we do. You have mental, is what we think. You have emotional, is what we feel. And then you have spirituality. And if we, spirituality is who we really are. And if we do not, and hear me clearly, if we do not have the spirituality inside of those four levels of self, then your spirituality is incomplete, because that, therefore, you don't have the physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual. You don't have all four components. So that means that you're missing something, and then there's going to be an incompleteness there. But once you put the spirituality there, then now you have your physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual. I just don't believe that people can do it by themselves. I've seen it. I've been in this field long enough to see that people always turn back to spirituality because they realize that they can't do it by themselves. My personal views on that and my personal experiences that I've experienced with others, they cannot obtain their sobriety or recovery without spirituality.
Okay, another question is, how does the strength-based approach work with spirituality?
The strength-based approach, I'm not sure exactly. Let me see, hold on. Strength-based approach works with spirituality. I'm gonna try to answer this as best as I know how, because I don't really understand the question.
So we can put that
well,
in.
I guess.
Go ahead and
I guess.
Also put it in the parking lot if that's something that we want to revisit via email.
Yeah, they can email me, and then I'll do some research on it, because I don't want to try to give you something just off the top of my head without me researching, because that's not who I am. If I don't know, I'll tell you, Dr. Nichols, don't know. So for that question there, if someone can email that to me, and I'll do research on that, and I'll be definitely glad to answer that one. So if someone can email that to me, I'll do research on it. And then once they email me with that question, then I'll be able to answer it after I do some research on it myself.
Another question that came in is, how do you promote spiritual guidance in someone who does not believe in spirituality?
Well, even if they don't believe in spirituality, they believe in a higher power. They believe in a higher being. They believe in something greater than themselves, because I've ran across a few people that, you know, that'll come and try to test my faith, I guess, and try to see if I'm really who I say I am. They say, well, I don't believe in God, so what do you have to say about that, Pastor? You know, so my thing is, okay, that's your choice if you don't believe in God. And then I pause, and they'll say, so you're not going to argue with me? I said, I don't argue with something that I strongly believe in, and I don't argue with someone else who doesn't believe in that. And then they began to be intrigued then from me saying that. And then they go to asking me questions. And so once I finish with, once I, well, how I explain it to people is this here. Well, you may see God in a different way. You may look at that tree out there and you may go and just sit and just talk. That tree may bring something to you, but there's still a higher power within, not the tree, but within yourself that you're searching for, that you don't really understand, know how, you don't understand how to tap into it. So once I talk to people on that level and I look at them as a human being and not trying to force them to believe what I believe and to believe the way I believe, then more people come back and they want to ask questions, and then they understand the difference between what they've been taught over the years as far as religion is concerned versus spirituality. So now they understand who they are and how they were designed and who designed them. So therefore, that's how I've approached it, you know, when people say that they don't believe in spirituality or whatever, and then they realize later on in life, oh, I do need a higher power. I just don't have to go to this particular church to do it. I don't have to go to this particular area to do it, but I can tap right here into myself and understand who he is and what he created me to do.
You go about infusing these principles into clinical mental health outside of addiction?
Well, what I do is the clinical part of it is one thing, then the spiritual part is another thing. But when you're looking at intertwining the two, you have to be careful, because you don't want to act as though that you are promoting religion, but you're also letting the person know about spirituality and knowing the difference, and then letting that person understand who they are, and then also helping that person develop their purpose. And so going on that spiritual journey, what I found in therapy, a lot of people are more receptive when you're trying to go from an angle of spirituality versus religion. And a lot of people will say, well, you know, I just want to do it this way because, you know, the Bible says this here, and they'll hold on to that one scripture that their pastor has taught them over the years, and the scripture literally doesn't mean that, But then once they understand their own purpose in life, that scripture then becomes awakened in a different light to them, because now it's like, oh, I get to think outside the box. I get to think for myself. I get to understand my mental state of mind. I get to understand the physical. I get to understand the emotional part of me. And now I get to understand the spiritual side of me. So that's how I intertwine the both. But I'm very, very cautious when I do that.
The last question that we have is, how may we receive more information from you regarding your webinar?
Okay, you guys can go back to the hold on, let's see if we can go back here for a second, because you can definitely hold on. This is the way that you can get in contact with me for any other information, or even with collaboration. I'm all about collaboration, because I think it is important that if I bring something to the table, you bring something different to the table, then we can help the person that we can help the whole person, in other words, because I can't do it all by myself. I also source out a lot, because if I know that I cannot help a person in a certain area, I am all about connecting people with those who are greater in that field than I am. If that's not my field, I'm not going to pretend that it is, because I think that it is important that we all tap into our spiritual being, understand our own purpose, stay in our own lane. That's how you get in contact with me. If you want to connect, that's how you get in contact with me. If you want referrals, I definitely refer out. I source out a lot, a lot. If I know that I can't do it, I'm not going to waste that person's time, because I think that that person doesn't have a lot of time to waste. So therefore, I'm trying to connect them immediately to people who's already in that particular field. So that's how they can get in contact with me, by preferably by email, or by cell phone. That's my direct line. That is my direct line. You can call me, we can talk, we can work together, we can make a
Okay, well,
difference.
thank you, Dr.
We can make a
Nichols. And on
difference.
behalf of our director, Don Tyus, and the SATTC here at Morehouse School of Medicine, we'd like to thank you. And please join us tomorrow. We have another wonderful webinar in store for you. We're celebrating Women's Month, and women are different. Tomorrow, 2 o'clock, we are going to have another speaker present information. And please join us. You can check, go to our website and get the registration information, and that's here. And so again, thank you, Dr. Nichols, and we look forward to you joining us tomorrow.
You're welcome.